Okay. Thank you, everyone, for coming so far. Hopefully more people will be filtering in as we start. This is Innovating the Future of Space, and we've certainly seen a lot of innovation over the past 10 to 15 years in this industry, probably the largest of which is the fact that this industry exists at all. What was previously the domain of the government and their legacy providers has now expanded to include commercial companies and enterprise and organizations that have two main goals, one being democratizing access to space for citizen science, exploration, commerce, and two being the expansion of Earth's economic sphere and creating a space ecosystem. And here with me today are three women at the forefront of that space ecosystem. So I'm going to briefly introduce them and then allow them to tell you a little bit more about where they plug in to this ecosystem and in the theme of this year's Women's Forum, what energizes them or motivates them about their work in space. So next to me is Anousheh Ansari. She's a serial entrepreneur and an astronaut. You heard her speak earlier yesterday at the beginning of the session. Next to her is Helene Huby. She's the head of innovation for Airbus, Space and Defense. And then Laetitia Garriott de Cayeux, who serves as the president of Escape Dynamics and is herself a former rising talent at the Women's Forum. I'm Kellie Gerardi. I work in the aerospace industry as well, and I'm a rising talent this year. So I would start sort of framing this question of where do you fit in the ecosystem and what energizes you by myself saying as someone very young in the career, I haven't had much experience in space, but I know what energizes me about working in this industry is the work that I do at a small rocket company where we work on reusable rocketry and precision landing, and my interest in going to space myself as an aspiring astronaut. And to me, the energizing fact about working in space is that this is the first time in 4 billion years where interplanetary life is possible. So I want to be a part of advancing mankind's ability to settle other worlds. So now I'll ask Anousheh to tell us a little bit about where she fits into this ecosystem. She has an extremely colorful history in space, and what energizes you about this industry?
So where I fit into this industry is in 2000, around 2000 is where first I started seriously entering this space and looking at possibility of going to space myself. And as part of that exploration, I was able to pair up with Peter Diamandis and eventually ended up being title sponsor of Ansari X Prize, which was a catalyst for change and starting up a lot of activities in the private space industry and, you know, creating the buzz, the interest, and by the fact that the prize was won in 2004, actually showing that it is possible, that there is an industry that can be made and that there's enough interest out there for it. And what energizes me is related to that. When I look at what has happened in 10 years, I'm very, very excited to see this, you know, really fast and rapid change that has happened, because if you go past 50 years, look at what had happened, not much changed in the way we were accessing space. And in just 10 years, there's so much more innovation, so many jobs have been created, so many new companies, and that tells me that we are finally getting on the same exponential path that many other technologies have been, and hopefully we see a lot of change happening in the next couple of decades.
Thanks a lot. So my role, I would say, or where I fit in the ecosystem. So Airbus is a very big player, a very traditional player, but also very innovative player. So we are building, I would say, traditional satellites, traditional launchers. But as you may know, we've won the OneWeb contract, which is a contract for 900 mini satellites. So this is really typical for a new space where you don't build these very big satellites that will last for years because the price of launch is so high that when you launch something, you want that the satellite stays in space as long as possible. But on the contrary, you launch very small satellites, very short lifetime, up to date from a technological point of view. And this is exactly what we're building now. So we have these two aspects of being the traditional player with the reliability that we are bringing to our clients. You may know that, you know, Ariane 5, we had more than 75 successful launch, so that's really very reliable, and that's really something we bring to our clients. And we also have this innovative spirit, producing, manufacturing, designing completely new spacecrafts with the OneWeb example, and partnering with startups and also investing in startups. You've perhaps heard that we've created an innovation center in the Silicon Valley, so at the very heart of the new space ecosystem. We have created a fund, and our willingness is more and more partnering with startups like Escape Dynamics, investing in these startups. So that's basically where I'm fitting. And why I'm energized by this, I would say, new trend, new space. I'm coming from the digital ecosystem. So I've seen the digital industry disrupting many businesses. Media first, then retail, now it's university, etc. So I think there is little sectors which are not disrupted by the digital industry today. And I'm convinced that the people who are now investing and I would say who are driving today this new space ecosystem, this is the same people that built the digital industry at the very beginning. It is Elon Musk, it is Eric Schmidt, it is basically the, I would say, probably the best CEOs of our world, it is Jeff Bezos. And they see that space, which was before something military, exactly like the internet before. It was something for the military area, is now coming to people, to each of you. And as in Airbus, we want to embrace this disruption, and I'm playing a role in this, so this is what energized me.
Thanks, Ellen, since we all thank each other. And so where we fit in the space industry is Escape Dynamics is one of the new space companies, and I think as has been already clear from the conversation we've had is new space companies have a common mission, and that common mission is to reduce the cost of access to space, traveling in space, and doing business in space. And if you look at the launch companies, the more the one that are most known would be the SpaceX, for example, X-Core. Some of the more recent one are Rocket Lab, Firefly, all have that same mission. Now, where we differ in our approach is that all those companies are relying on the same technology that we've been using for the 50 years we've been going to space, that of chemical combustion. And what we're doing at Escape Dynamics is that we're proposing to move beyond chemical combustion for space launch and instead to rely on beamed energy in the form of high-power microwave that is beamed to the rocket. And what is very unique about that is that it has the capability to enable single-stage flights to orbit and aircraft-like operations to space. And so what energizes me is that is to be working on developing a technology that has a means to reduce space launch cost by a factor of about 100 times if you look at the smaller mass bins. Helene was talking about smaller satellites, and she was mentioning Constellation was, I think, 900 of them, right? So you could imagine that in any single year, you probably want to launch about 200, 250, so you can renew your satellite fleet. And so that fleet servicing capability with a smaller launcher that is reusable and function essentially like an airplane becomes possible, and that is very exciting to me.
Thank you. So when we're talking about the space industry, I've personally found that it's difficult to sort of communicate the message of why interest in space is so critical outside of the space industry. I mean, often at space conferences, it feels like we're in an echo chamber telling each other how fantastic all of these innovations are and how exciting of a future we all have to look forward to. But that message often stays in the conference and has trouble penetrating the public imagination, and you can see why when you think to the question, well, what does space have to do with my life? Yes, it's very exciting, but how does this affect my life in 2015? So I'm curious to hear from you, what would you consider to be some of the largest societal benefits that the space industry provides us? And since I'm acting in the dual role as both moderator and panelist, I'm going to give my two cents on it as well, and note that Anousheh's mission to space really was a pathfinder for someone like me as a student who was looking at this incredible woman as an example of what I could achieve coming from a different sector or coming just with pure inspiration and wanting to be a part of this. In the entire history of our experience as a species in space, less than 600 people have been to space in the last half century of manned spaceflight. Less than 600. And so to me, looking at this space ecosystem that's emerging and looking at new types of launch vehicles, new types of propulsion, new innovation, and a new class of citizen scientists all represented on this panel, I am encouraged by the fact that we could double the amount of people who have ever been to space in the next 5 to 10 years alone. So that to me is sort of a big societal benefit because it allows for citizen science and exploration and direct engagement with space. But I would love to hear from the three of you what you consider to be the societal benefits we can expect.
So I face that a lot. And when I go talk to general public where they're not exposed to a lot of space, you know, talk like we do in conferences, I have to first remind them of the benefit that it has already provided the society because they don't associate a lot of things we use on a daily basis, whether it's our communication system, entertainment system, GPS, a lot of things around us sort of have their start from the space program. So first I have to set the record straight for them to understand that it has already provided tremendous amount of benefit in multiple different industries. But that in future, as the launch cost is lowered, then it opens up a whole new opportunity for new types of companies that can be built to experiment more in space, to create new materials, new medicine, new treatments. The possibilities are endless. And it's also a necessity for us to look at that because, as our species grows on our planet and the population grows, just relying on resources on our planet will not be enough to satisfy the needs we have. And if what's happening out there is an indication, there's no sight on people turning back on the way they consume material and grow. So we have to look at other options, and space provides us that other option. And it's not something that we can do overnight, so we have to invest in it now in order to be able to expand in other parts of the universe and also access the resources and bring them back to Earth to benefit us here.
Yeah. So it was already, I would say, very complete. So perhaps I will distinguish today, tomorrow, and I would say the day after tomorrow. So today is, as you said, it's GPS, I think, first. And second, I would say all what relates to communication, broadcast, so TV, and also imagery, especially for military purposes. Tomorrow, and really tomorrow, and it means probably 1 to 5 years, it is, for imagery, it is a lot of B2C imagery. So I'm thinking about agriculture, I'm thinking about traffic jams, I'm thinking about predicting, if you just look at, how many cars have been in a parking, you can also predict the turnover of that supermarket, for example, and then you can predict the turnover of the company who owns that supermarket, and etc. So there is a lot of business that, thanks to imagery, will pop up, thanks to this Planet Labs, Skybox, Constellation that we are that will fly in 1 to 5 years. Communication also in 1 to 5 years. It is internet for the billions of the people who do not have internet on the Earth today. Space is part of the answer. It is not the answer, but it is part of the answer because it's much cheaper to provide internet through space than through terrestrial networks. Just to give you one figure, OneWeb, we are talking about, today they've raised 550 million. We are talking about a total investment of 3 billion. And if you think, 3 billion, this is less than the terrestrial network you would need for France, right? So it means you can really provide internet at a cheaper price through space. So that's for the tomorrow, and the day after tomorrow, it is what you mentioned. It is resources. It is also medicines. In microgravity, for example, you can do experiments with cells that are much more efficient than what you can do on the Earth, just because you can grow cells in 3D, which is in an easier way out of gravity than what you can do on the Earth. But this only, I would say, relies on what Laetitia is building, that is to say, diminishing the cost of launch. If they don't diminish, none of this market will be opened.
Yeah, no, so I think cost of launch is critical, and it will democratize access, and as Kellie said, allow not just hundreds of people to go to space, but 7 billion. You know, we should all have this opportunity that Anousheh had to look back at the beauty of Earth or work in space one day. But I think I want to rebound on one of the things you mentioned, Helen, which is connectivity and internet. And I think in my mind, one of the greatest things that space is going to enable through constellation of satellite, or is going to be one of the key elements, is uncensored internet everywhere and for all. And space-based constellation of satellite are only a part of the answer. We're going to need governance. We're going to need spectrum allocation. We're going to need some small antenna receivers that are the size of USBs and you know, cost less than $5, so you can dump thousands of them above North Korea or other places that, you know, it's difficult to get anything uncensored. But I think in terms of betterment for civil society across the world, that's something that space is really going to strengthen and allow.
And I think all of these things are indications of game-changing innovation over the last 10 years. The fact that we're able to even sit today and talk about a constellation of small satellites that could provide internet to the entire world, that is a change of orders of magnitude and technology availability and development. And so I'm very vocal about the fact that I one day want to go to Mars. That's sort of my dream. I want to go to space 100%, but I also would like to go to Mars. So when I look at game-changing technologies in this sector, and what do we look at in the last 10 to 15 years or upcoming technologies that we think will really be the difference, whether incremental or radical innovation, that are really, what is the game changer that you would point to that really is one of the most exciting things you can think of about innovation? For me, it's the work that I do at Masten Space Systems, my rocket technology company that I work at in the US, and we are pioneering reusable rocketry with precision landing. And the sort of illustrative example I like to give is, if you want to land on Mars, right now you need to land on a flat and scientifically uninteresting area, because there can be no hazards on the ground that could potentially jeopardize the mission. And then once you land, you need to traverse large distances to go to a scientifically interesting area, which our rovers do. However, with the ability to precision land, that guidance, navigation, and control during descent to another planet, that allows to land with pinpoint accuracy at a base where you could ferry supplies or land humans. So to me personally, in my goals, that's this game-changing technology that I look at as something that will help enable me to one day go to Mars. But I would love to hear from each of you, what is a game-changing technology that really excites you or you think has been a threshold?
So, of course, outside of Escape Dynamics and their great work, another technology I'm very excited about is 3D printing in space. And I think can be definitely a game changer in terms of allowing us to do things in space and create and print things and manufacture things in space instead of carrying it up there. Because as we start, you know, looking at building a base on the moon and hopefully going to Mars, definitely having that capability brings a lot of value and flexibility, because we can think of everything we need when we go up there, and we're bound to remember we needed something we left back on Earth, and coming back and getting it will take, you know, if you're on Mars, years to get it. So definitely I think it will be a necessity and game changer in how far we can go.
So I'd like to answer your question actually on the why side of the business, because there is also some game changing business models that appeared with this constellation story. For me, it's a little bit like, you know, the computer before. You wanted to build very reliable, very big computers, you know, like a company, for example, like digital equipment, very big one. And now it's a complete different model. It is less reliable. It is Kleenex satellite, and this enables the satellite to be really up to date from the technological point of view. So this is not, I would say, per se new technology. Indeed, it has been possible because of new technology, but it's incremental innovation more than, you know, disruptive new technology. But that's a complete shift in the mentality and in the business model. And I think that's really a big disruptive point. The other one, and here we haven't found a solution, I'm convinced that new propulsion techniques will appear. There are some companies like you, yours, who are working on that. There are others. And, you know, bringing things to space is all about energy. So today we are using, as you said, chemical rockets. I'm convinced new will appear, perhaps beamer, perhaps nuclear technologies, perhaps electrical power. I mean, several companies are working on this. And if one succeeds, this one will disrupt the space market.
And as far as I saw, obviously, I'm very excited about what I'm doing, which is microwave-powered beamed propulsion for space launch. But I also want to mention another electromagnetic-based propulsion, which is for in-space propulsion, and that's the technology developed by Ad Astra, started by the astronaut Franklin Cheng Diaz. And what their technology allows is to travel to Mars in less than 6 weeks. And so that will allow people like Kellie, who are dying to go to Mars, to go to Mars. And perhaps I'll have to jump on that ship with you if Trump wins the election in the U.S.
Count me in on that ship, too.
Exactly. Hashtag entrepreneurs for Hillary, of course.
Amazing. I agree completely, and I want to keep it on Mars for a second selfishly, just because it's a topic that really has captured my mind. And to be honest, I'm not particular whether it's Mars or the moon. In fact, I think there's a really good argument for starting at something so close to home and proving out these technologies before we make such a big permanent trip. And in this subject of sort of space settlement and the future of humanity and sort of each of your risk profiles in that regard, start with a very quick background. I spent about 3 weeks in isolation last year with a group of international scientists from NASA, ESA, and JAXA at a Mars desert station, a prototype laboratory in the middle of the desert where we were on a simulated mission to Mars. And it was, high fidelity in the sense that we had an airlock that could not be breached. We wore spacesuits outside. We ate rehydrated foods. It was like adult space camp, but with real science. So it was, of course, to me, the highlight of my life, but it also gave a really somber view of what one could expect living on another planet forever, and that survival would really be a full-time job. And so there's been a lot of talk about sort of travel to the Mars or to the moon or space settlement with the intent to stay. And I'm just curious, a few things. First, Anousheh, would you go back to space again, even if it wasn't a one-way mission, of course? Did that satisfy your need for space travel to go once, or is it somewhere you want to visit?
No, it made it worse. Now I want to go more. No, definitely it's something that, at least in my case, once you experience it, you just crave for it that much more. And if I had a choice, I would go live in space. I would never come back. So it's definitely something I look forward to, whether it's Mars, Moon, you know, space station again. I'm even ready as soon as Virgin Galactic starts flying to actually just do a suborbital and come back.
Yeah, so you'll be back in space. And Helene, what about you? Working in the space industry, do you also share a dream to go to space yourself, or are you happy here on Earth just helping forward mankind's ability to increase our footprint in space? Do you have aspirations to go to space?
So I would love going to space, but really what excites me, it's moving this very big company to our buildings, you know, new ways to go to space. So it's really, I would say, an Earth-driven.
Earth-driven. Fair. And Laetitia, what about you? What is your risk profile as you look at space? Was this with your technology, is this something that you one day want to be on board?
Yeah, one day I'll be on board, but not the test flights. Let's put it that way.
That's fair enough. So I wanted to take at least a few minutes to have any questions from the audience. We have three incredible women. And this is a really great opportunity. That's very sweet. Yes. I think we can hear you, or I can repeat the question, too.
Sorry, I was just saying hi. I'm Shelley Porges, Washington, D.C. I'm an entrepreneur for Hillary, like Laetitia. what you painted a great picture of the exciting things you see coming and the exciting benefits you see deriving from what's going to be happening, what is happening in space exploration and innovation. But would you talk a little bit about, first of all, what are experts today talking about in terms of the top risk that is associated with this? And, you know, for those of us like myself, a layperson, we, you know, envision all kinds of things. But what are experts talking about when they talk about the top risk? And then, most importantly, what are they not talking about that you've thought about that represents a potential risk as we are moving forward, as we're thinking about, you know, these important things?
Okay, that's a great question. Perhaps I'll just start with a sort of vague addressment. So risk, at least as I'm interpreting risk, could be a couple different things. I think if we're thinking about it in terms of planetary settlement, perhaps radiation is a big risk. Currently, as Laetitia mentioned, the technology is not quite there to get us all the way to somewhere like Mars in only 6 weeks or a short flight. Currently, I think state of the art would be 7 months. So not only is there significant radiation exposure on the way to a far out destination, but once you're there with very little thin atmosphere, offers very little protection against harmful rays. So that's certainly something that the medical community within the space industry is thinking a lot about. And then to the second part of your question, what are people not thinking about? And something that I think a lot about are property rights in space. You're still operating in the UN Treaty of 1967 with regard to not being able to own any property outside of space. And if we truly want to stimulate a space economy and incentivize business to operate in that economy, we are going to need to untangle many decades worth of legal sort of issues that have not been discussed on a public forum before and are only just now starting to be debated about how that will work.
If I may just jump on the Outer Space Treaty, because we're the only private owner of a celestial body, you know,
Please explain that.
So we actually, my husband and I own a rover that had been lost for many years and that was bought on auction when it had been long lost. And a couple of years ago, it reappeared. And we even have photographs and sort of know where it was on the moon. So
to clarify, she owns something that is currently sitting on the moon, a rover on another world.
Theoretically, according to the Outer Space Treaty of, I think, 1967 or so, so no country is allowed to own celestial bodies, but private companies and private individuals are not precluded from owning anything in space. And that's for now the regulation. There was another treaty in 1979, the Moon Treaty, but it was not right. And it tried to preclude private owners from owning any celestial body, but that was not ratified by the major spacefaring nations. So we're still dealing with 1967. But the point I wanted to make about risk is that I think for me, space, the risk in space are the unknown. They're the things that you really have not thought about because simply there have been so many few people that have gone, and I'm thinking about one of our friend, Italian astronaut, Luca Parmitano, ESA astronaut, who some of you may have followed that, and if not, I would encourage you to go and Google his name and droning in space. And Luca was on a spacewalk, and water started flowing through on his head and his eyes and his nose and his mouth up to the point that he was completely blind, could not hear any command, and realized he had to rush back somehow and make his way back into the spacecraft so he doesn't die and droning in space. And he made it, so that's the lucky part of the story. But that's an issue that had never occurred before on a spacewalk. And I think that's one thing to realize with space is there will always be new things that, you know, more than with any other things, because we're not at a flight rate at a that is high enough yet.
Perhaps we'll answer your question a bit differently. Space is already and will tomorrow be more and more a space for war, actually. So that's a big risk I see. Another one I see is the debris. Today, I mean, I think most of you have seen the film Gravity. It is up to date. So the risk is there. It's not tomorrow. It's there. But nobody wants to pay for removing debris from space. So we are waiting for, I guess, something that will happen. And the last today is perhaps a business risk. I'm quite convinced that we are living in a bubble for the new space company, this new space economy, which is a bit little similar to the bubble we had in the 19th of the internet. When you see the valuation of the company and when you compare this valuation with their asset and also with the profit they would be able to make, these are huge valuation. And indeed, if some company fails or if the company which today have the best valuation are not able to prove that from an operational point of view it will work, then we will have a huge new space crisis, and a few, as always, the best will recover. But that's, I think, also a risk for the new space industry.
And the only thing I would add is, you know, an early accident that will cost life of a private citizen will be a huge setback. So I'm worried, because space is still risky and dangerous. And if something goes wrong, then I think everyone will start, you know, trying to scale back, and it will be a huge setback, which I hope we don't see that happen.
I agree. Do we have any other questions in the back?
Thank you. My question is perhaps going to sound queer, but we go in space, and it's this space which is so big. Do you think that there's other human beings in space that could come here on Earth one day?
I'll take this one, because I was visiting SETI recently. So the SETI is focused on search for extraterrestrial intelligent life. The chances to find life, not forget intelligence, I mean, is already small, but intelligent life, I think they, not SETI, but people like Stephen Hawking would say it's 0.1 to 1% chance. So it's very low. We've seen water on Mars, as you probably saw recently, and as we know on Earth, I mean, when there's water, there's life, but we don't think the water has been there long enough that life has been able to necessarily evolve. So it's unlikely it's intelligent, it's advanced. It's, we'll likely find some form of life, but it's the chances it's more advanced than us is very small.
But what about these OVNI, which are apparently pilots say they see it, they see them,
so
and it's not hallucination, but
yeah, oftentimes. So every so the people that report those sightings of you know, first you have to look at who the person is, and then even if the person maybe someone who is on the space station astronaut, even amongst astronaut, you know, there are a couple who just think a little differently and believe in supernatural powers and that people can see the future. So they're humans like we are, and it's funny. My father-in-law is an astronaut, and he had had a sighting, and he never said, he's extremely scientific and does not believe in anything extra natural, but he had mentioned that sighting, and it was misinterpreted as maybe he saw, you know, extraterrestrial life, which he's always very pissed about when people bring up to him. And whatever he had seen was later justified, but it takes time to find what those things are that you may see, so.
I agree, and just to bounce off of what Laetitia said about life, I fully expect, perhaps too optimistically, but I fully expect that in my lifetime, life will be discovered elsewhere in the universe, hopefully in our solar system, but it will be, in my mind, microbial life. Certainly not visualizing, at least I'm not visualizing anything more advanced than that. I think it would be groundbreaking to find evidence even in the far, far past of microbial life. And to me, it makes me think of, where did life originate from? Is it perhaps, you know, an asteroid that carried microbial life knocking into a planet like Earth? Or, you know, so too, can we create life on Mars by bringing microbial life and creating an environment where it can foster? So to me, those are sort of exciting things to look forward to in the future, but to your original question about intelligent life, I remain pessimistic about that.
Okay, thank
I
you.
I don't know if any.
Well, my husband thinks I'm an alien, so.
Jury is out. Does anyone else have a question?
There is a risk that an asteroid hits the Earth, and I've heard about a project in the U.S. You know, of some people, you know, trying to map all the asteroids around the solar system, and you know, being able to launch, you know, a rocket to an asteroid and deviate it and so on. I find it very fascinating, and in terms of social impact, concrete for people, you know, this is something huge. But I was wondering, you know, whether you had up-to-date information and whether, you know, it's credible and how this could progress.
Sure. A part of the B612 is the organization that was formed by a couple of the astronauts, and last year they launched this Asteroid Day. So it was an awareness day for everyone to know about that. Yes, there is a possibility, and unless we know what are the risks, identify those asteroids and be able to take action very, very early on, that we don't really have the technology or means to prevent it. So the mission is to basically launch a telescope that would identify and map out all the asteroids that could cause a potential danger of hitting our planet. And if such thing happens to be discovered, then we can very early on create a small nudge that in space, a small nudge, that means that it will miss the Earth. So that's what the plan is, and that's what the ambitious dream of people who started it. And there's funding going on, and there's talks of maybe doing a crowdfunding, but the work continues, and we're very optimistic about it.
And then there is also an effort by Lockheed Martin, a space fence, so, and there were some recent news on that that you can check out.
And then very finally, I think NASA is also, and I double check me online if that's incorrect, but I think they're also partnered with Planetary Resources on a global effort for civilians to help spot nearby asteroids. So by taking the volumes and volumes of data that we receive, you can use your own computer to download that and help NASA sift through potentially riskful asteroids. So yeah, it is cool though to see that citizen science again be able to engage with big agency. So it is a global effort.
And industry. We also have
and
a product.
Most importantly, industry. And I think we had a question in the front.
As we are on the Women Forum, I would like to ask you, what are your strengths as a woman to work on the space industry? What do you think about that?
So my work is in technology. My professional work is in technology. So I think it is kind of like the space industry. There are, you know, a very small number of women in especially leadership positions. But as other industry, things are changing. Now, let me just maybe spend a little bit of time on aerospace industry specifically. And aerospace industry is suffering from lack of interest in general, men or women. So there is a considered effort by people who are involved to generate interest. And the only way we can generate interest is to show that this is not a small industry just for a few selected, you know, right stuff type of people, but it is for everyone, and that it is accessible to everyone. And I think with that, we generate enough interest in our young people to go study in these fields and become, you know, leaders and involved in the industry in the future.
Okay, so there is not that many women in the aerospace industry, indeed. It's also because it's very engineering driven. I mean, it's not that easy to build a rocket or to build a satellite. It's really, I mean, the culture is an engineering culture. So, indeed, I mean, I'm also working in various countries, and especially in Germany, when, I mean, women, lots of women, they tend to stay at home, or they have to make a choice, career, and you see Angela Merkel is a typical example of this, a very successful one, or children, but two together are difficult. And I have four children. So at the beginning, I was perceived like, okay, is she really serious? I even had people telling me, please, don't say the others that you have children, because it will discredit you completely. And so what drives me, because indeed, I mean, you get, at least I get remarks and et cetera, it is really passion and impact. And if you see, you know, the way we have changed within Airbus, the way we have embraced the disruption of space, we've been working all together, men and women, but at the end we had an impact, and absolutely no difference in that common enthusiasm. I'm referring to building this center in Silicon Valley, winning the OneWeb contract, etc. You know, at the end, and I think that's unique to us space people, we are passionate. I found this passion in all the engineers I'm working with, men or women, and they really don't care about you're a man or you're a woman, but they care about how much passion you have for space.
I agree with that. I think that the space industry, like Helene said, is really full of mission-oriented people. And oftentimes, if you're truly a mission-oriented person, anything peripheral is not your focus. And I've also had the same experience. I think my peers who are perhaps in other verticals within the tech industry have had maybe more difficult experiences, or so I've heard. But myself in aerospace, I feel privileged to have been surrounded by very strong mentors. And in fact, Laetitia and her husband, Richard, were both mentors and sponsors to me entering the industry. So I, you know, not only did I have a strong female who also has children as a sort of pathfinder in entering this, but even male mentors to me were extremely welcoming. And I've really felt comfortable for the entirety of my at least short career so far. So I'm grateful to that. And I think we have a lot of strong female leaders to look up to, not only the three on this stage, but I can think off the top of my head of many, but of many women in leadership positions in aerospace. So I think that's really encouraging. And I do think, like Helene said it best, that this is really a mission-oriented culture that perhaps helps with that. Do you have anything to add to that, Lizzie? Yes. Okay, so if there are there any other questions? We might have time for one last question. No? Okay, so I would like to just give everyone a chance to give one closing statement. If you want people in this room to take away anything about the space industry or what to look forward to in the future, or you know what they can care about in space, what would that be? For me, I would caution everyone to think critically about the fact that one day Earth will cease to support life, and that's just a fact. So, you know, right now, as Stephen Hawking says, we have all of our eggs on one planet, and in just proper risk mitigation, we need to expand beyond that. And as Anousheh said earlier, we can't start that the moment that crisis hits. We need to start that now so that in the future we're able to support life support systems and advanced technology that enable people to settle other worlds. So that would be my closing thoughts. Anousheh?
I would say that a lot of exciting things are happening in space, and it's worth learning about and knowing about. If you have children, encourage them to read about it and inspire them, because I think it will become a very critical factor in our future and our sustainability as a life form. So we do need a lot more attention in this industry than we're getting right now.
Yeah, so I would say if I look in the past, space has already brought a lot of humanity. I mean, as I said, GPS, etc., lots of technologies also, I mean, water cleaning, etc. And if the new space industry is successful, there is still a if. I think we've seen only 1% of what space can bring to humanity. So that's a good, very good future for, as you said, children and also industry.
And who has seen The Martian in this room? Okay, not that many, actually. I'm surprised. So everyone else, go see The Martian. my favorite moment in The Martian was when it sounded like a desperate situation and China raised their hand and said, we can help. And to me, it was beautiful because it showed that, you know, big spacefaring nation can sometime cooperate in some situation. And I hope we see more of that for asteroid, for example, deflection and things that really matter to all of us. So.
Exactly. So I hope everyone has something to look forward to in the next few years in space. And thank you so much to Anousheh, to Helene, and to Laetitia for joining me on stage today. Let's give them a round of applause.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.